principles, and you will memorize that, and you will keep that in mind throughout the year. All right, that's what we're going to do. So God work through principles. There are many principles that we see that was revealed in the nature and also in the world, because principles make our life predictable. And if you violate God's principles, you are not breaking them, you are only breaking yourself. So there are many principles that we see. There are four principles we are going to learn. This is very simple, and you all will be able to memorize it, and this is applicable to all of us, but especially for our youngsters and children, we talk about this. Principle number one, this is a principles for a productive life, or it is a guidelines for our journey through our life, any way you can call. Principle number one, you were created to be responsible. Can you say that together? You are created to be responsible. One more time. You are created to be responsible. So we are living in a world that irresponsibility is celebrated and even rewarded. So there is always people talk about their right rather than their responsibility. That is a world that we are living in. So people talk about always, you know, their right, what they have to get rather than their responsibilities. But that become a escapism for many people, and because they always shift their responsibility to someone else and always blame. And look at that, there is a lot of research and studies and all kinds of things people try to bring it for their irresponsibility. Responsibility and irresponsibility are not big things for us to understand. It's a very simple thing to understand. But irresponsibility is something, a very subtle sin. And we are able to see in somebody's life, it is very difficult for us to see in our life. That's the thing. So we try to understand that. The scripture teaches that, the Bible talk about that, even before God created man, even before sin, even before anything was there, the first thing that God asked the people, or Adam and Eve, or what God has given to them, was responsibility. Let's read the scripture, for this is famous scripture to all of us, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Remember that sometimes always people ask, whenever you want to say Genesis 1 and 2, we are sick and tired of it. I know that you are tired of it, but each time you go there, why? Because in order to understand whatever that happened, we need to understand the original, what was God's original intention and plan was. So God's original plan that we see in Genesis chapter 1 and 2. So how the original things were looked. And so we see that in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. If you have Bible, you can look there. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Children, I say very slowly to get it. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. This is what the Bible says. The Lord God took the man, Adam, and put him in the Garden of Eden. For what? To watch TV and to play a video game and sleep. Is what it is? No. Read that, what it says. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. The Lord commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, or when you eat of it, you will surely die. Before sin was in the world, what you see there? There was responsibility. In chapter 1, verse 28, Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, there we see that there are four responsibilities that God has given. Work and take care of it. Again, remember that those who are progressive, they think that this taking care of environment as like their agenda, there is something they invented of it all. But this was God's idea from the beginning itself, to take care of the planet. Before global warming and global colding and all these things, God's desire for man was to take care of the planet. That was responsibility. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28, there are four responsibilities, says that. One is be fruitful, increase in number, and multiply and subdue the earth. Be fruitful, multiply and subdue the earth. And this was, or govern the earth, or guard the earth, take care of the earth. That was the responsibility that God has given to man. That was a responsibility. So before anything else, what God gave them? Responsibility. So responsibility come from where? From God himself. So before anything was there, God created man and put him in the garden and gave them the responsibility to take care of the garden. That was God's response. That's God's command to the people. But what happened? Let's go further. We all know that. Genesis chapter 3. What happened then? The response, where did irresponsibility start then? Irresponsibility started in chapter 3, verse 1 through 3 or 4 that we see. What happened? The tempter and the notorious, infamous conversation between the serpent or the tempter and between Eve that we see over there. What happened there? The tempter came and or the serpent came and talked to Eve. What was the conversation like? You remember that? Did God really say it? You know, he tried to plant a doubt in her heart. So that was the beginning of it. So the tempter came and did God really say, you must not eat from the tree in the garden? Verse 2 of chapter 3, the woman said to the serpent, we may eat food from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat food from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die. So what happened? Then the devil answered to that question. He said, he brought another objection. Said, no. You are not going to die at all. This is very good for you. So you just try to eat that. God doesn't want you to have fun. That is why God said you should not do it. If you take this, it will be very fun and you go ahead and do it. Then we see that the tempter came, brought that temptation, and finally she listened to the serpent or the tempter than God. She forsake the responsibility that God has given to them. What happened? She ate it. And that is what the irresponsibility that came into this world. And God showed up there. God will not go sin unpunished. So God showed up there, that we see in chapter 3. Again, we all know this story well, right? We all know the story. God showed up and asked them. And God made Adam accountable for this action. And God asked this question. There is the famous conversation between Adam and God then. What happened? God asked Adam, where are you? That was the question. Adam, where are you? His answer, you know, he answered, I heard you in the garden, verse 10, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. Remember that when you sin, you do all kind of dumb things. So what is Adam is doing here? He is hiding from the all-knowing God. Is he can hide from God? No. But he tried to hide from God. That is what he is trying to do. Then we see a cycle over there. This is what happens universally then and now. This happens always in the family or life or anywhere else. When you do your responsibility, there is always a sense of fulfillment. There is a feeling that I did a good job, right? Because when you do your responsibility, you always feel good. That is a good feeling. That is a God-given feeling. When you don't do your responsibility, what happened? You are miserable. What happened then? The next thing what happened? Here we see Adam is doing something. He is not only, you know, just sad over there. He is hiding. He shunned the gift that God has given to him. What was that gift? The gift was Eve, right? When first time he saw Eve, he wrote a poem there. And he sent a text to her all of a sudden, actually, you are the bone of my bones and the flesh of my flesh. Honey, I love you and fall in love with you. All those wonderful things. He became a poet all of a sudden. But here, he says that this woman that you gave, he is shunning the gift of God there. The moment he become irresponsible. Next one, what happened? He is not only shunning the gift of God, he is blaming God. He says that you put her here. I was very happy. Many men think that actually, right? So they were very happy without you. The moment you came, that is all this problem came along with that. So he is blaming God then. So he sinned or they disobeyed. They were irresponsible. And the irresponsibility bring conflict. Then the conflict bring blame. Blame bring shame. Shame bring, because of shame. Why there is shame? Because there is guilt. Why there is guilt? Because they lied. When there is lying, there is hiding. There is a whole cycle of confusion going on over there, we see. Start with the responsibility, then with the blame, then there is shame, then there is guilt, then there is lying, then there is hiding. Everything was gone south. Why? Because one man or one woman become irresponsible. That is the second point. The first thing is that so God has created all of us as responsible beings. There is a responsibility in each season of life. Remember that. There is responsibility. As children, your responsibility is to study in your faith, be faithful in your study. Because you have everything is given to you. You don't have to go to work to make money, to go to school. You have to think about where the shoe come, where the food come, from the book come, where the shelter come, there is roof come. Nothing to worry about at all. The only responsibility in the season of the life that you are in is what? You to study. In Pave school district, there is 120 children go to bed every single day without food. This is not in China. There is not in Antarctica or Africa or India or Uttar Pradesh. It is in Pave where you are living in. 120 children go to bed without food every day. So there is a lot of churches and charity organizations come together. When you go to the North County and go to the East, there is this strategy. The strategy is more than this. So you don't have to worry about any of those things. You are granted all these things. So your season of life, your responsibility is to what? To study. That's all your responsibility. When you get older, you become a mature person, your responsibility is to take care of your life, your body, your soul, God has given to you. As parents, they have a responsibility. As a husband, there is responsibility. There is wife, there is responsibility. There is grandparents, there is responsibility. Each season of life, our responsibility changes. Our duty changes. But we all are responsible for all these seasons of life. So our job is to be responsible. The moment we become irresponsible and you become irresponsible, that affects everyone else around you. That is a thing. So remember that, number one, God created us as responsible beings. So you were created to be responsible. Principle number one, you were created to be responsible. This school year remind you every day that I am responsible for my grade, my study, my choices. It is your responsibility. So let's say that one more time. You were created to be responsible. Say louder, children. The cycle that happened. The second thing what happened, many people, we came from a collective society to an individualistic society. So many things we try to communicate, people think that because of the culture. You came from that culture, that's why you are saying this is a different thing. But many things are not only cultural, it is scriptural also. If it is cultural, there is value, but you can debate about it. But it is scriptural, you don't have an opinion about it, you have to follow and obey it. So this is what the scripture teaches also here from that incident in Genesis chapter 3 that we understand. Irresponsibility is not a personal or neutral thing. Irresponsibility is not a personal or neutral thing. Say this with me. Irresponsibility is not a neutral or personal. Irresponsibility is not a neutral or a personal thing. What happened? Romans chapter 5 verse 12. Romans 5 12. Paul writes about the disobedience of Adam. Why the mess that we are in today? Paul writes this. He says that through one man's sin, through one man, sin entered the world. Through sin, death came to whom? To all. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and this way death came to all people. Because do you sin? You been in Garden of Eden? No. Who sin? Adam sin. When Adam sinned, what happened? It affected everybody. So this is to understand actually, responsibility is not a personal thing. Someone has to pay the bill. A drunk driver violates the law and jumps the red light, hitting an innocent person, that person's life is in jeopardy, in trouble. Did he do anything? No. This one person violated the thing. Remember that anything that you do, it is not only affecting you, it is affecting your family. As a community, that affects all of us. So we don't think, oh, it's my life, it's my choice, who are you to ask me? That may be an objection that you have, but that is not what it is. Because you cannot sin in a vacuum. Sin is against God, sin is against other people. So you cannot sin in vacuum. You can sin in isolation. Your sin affects others. Remember that. Everybody is affected. Everybody is touched by that. That is an important thing. That is what happened with Adam thing. And last week also I said this. In Joshua chapter 7. There we read about a person. The people of Israel. Those who are traveling. And they are going to the promised land. They came to Jericho. Jericho was built against huge walls. But they walked around that, Jericho came down in Joshua chapter 6. And they were so excited, they were overconfident in one way. Then they came to the next city, it's a small city called Ai. They said, it's only a few thousand people have to go for that, don't worry about it. They didn't even pray, they didn't ask for God's guidance, they didn't ask any of those things. They were very confident because they did that yesterday, so because they can do this also. They just went, but the people just defeated them. Why they were defeated? You know, Joshua came before God and said, God, how could you can do this? Because this is an embarrassment to you. That is what Joshua said. God said, no, wait a minute, I will tell you. That's not the case. It is not because of anything that I do or didn't do. It is there is sin in the camp. There is violation of God's principle. God said, you do not take any of the plunder from there. But there's somebody, one person took it. So all of a sudden they called the general body. They called all these 2 million people, those who are coming together. They came together. They went by the tribe by tribe, clans by clans, family by family. Then came to this person. You know, there is a man called Achan, Carbi's son, from the tribe of Judah. You know, he caught there. And Joshua went and asked him, my son, what did you have done? And it was his answer. Achan's answer was this, I have sinned. In Joshua chapter 7, verse 21, there we see that Joshua, Achan says that, I have sinned. And there we see in Joshua chapter 7, verse 21, the same thing what Eve has done in Genesis chapter 3. He said, I saw, I coveted, I took, I hide. This is the progression of sin at all the time. I saw, I coveted, I took, then I hide. The moment you know that you do in violation of God's principle, the next thing try to do is you go in isolation. You don't want to be associated with the people of God. You want to set away from all these things. That is another strategy of the enemy also. When you live in isolation, that is where the devil works more than. You don't want to come to the fellowship. You don't want to be associated with anyone else. Go further and further. But God's eyes was upon him. I have seen, I coveted, I took, I hide. Remember that whatever you do, God's eyes are always upon us. That is what we read in the morning in Psalm. So God saw him, and what happened because of that? And there he was punished over there. Look at here. You know, thousands of people, those who are going, none of them didn't do anything wrong. But once one person's mistake that affected everyone around them. This morning, children, remember that your choices, the friendship that you make, the choices that you take, the decision that you take in your life, it's not only affecting you. It is affecting your parents. It is affecting your community, because this is a community thing. That is why there is confrontation. Sometimes people think that if you confront the irresponsibility of people, they ask, who are you to judge me? But that is a spiritual thing to do. Why? Because if you don't do that, they will go to the same path. That is where the parents confront you. That is where the elders confront you. That is where the teachers confront you. It is not because they don't love you. Because they love you, that is why they do it. If they don't do it, what happens? It will go further and further. If it is not confronted, this irresponsibility will be rewarded, they think, and they will go south like that. So that is the reason. So remember that it is not a cultural thing. Irresponsibility is not a personal thing. It is not a neutral thing. It will affect so many other people around you. So principle number one, God has created us as responsible being. Number two, irresponsibility is not a neutral thing. Then you don't do your responsibility as students, and you don't do your thing. You think that the Asian parents are only concerned about education. You know, there is no fun at all. Remember that it is the part of your responsibility. If you don't do it, what happens next? We will understand that. Third principle is this. Principle number one, that you are created to be responsible. Principle number two, irresponsibility is no neutral nor personal. Number three, today is connected to tomorrow. Today is connected to tomorrow. Principle number three, let's say that. Today is connected to tomorrow. Proverbs chapter 27 verse 12. Let's read that together. The prudent see danger and take refuge, but the simple keep going and pay the penalty. The prudent, the wise, see danger and take refuge. But the simple, the naive, the simpleton keep going and pay the penalty. Very simple. There is nothing to explain here at all. What do you see there? There are two kinds of people. What are the two kinds of people? One is wise. The other one is a simple person or a naive person. Some translations say naive person. Or a fool, we can say. You know, if fool is too offensive, you know, they can say naive. It is a more nice word. So two kinds of people. One is wise. The other one is naive. What happened then? Two of them see the same thing. But two take two different reactions. So two different outcomes before that. Two people, same thing they see two different actions. Result is what? Two different reactions or two different outcomes. What happened with the prudent or the wise man? The wise man understands that life is connected. He understands the cause and effect relationship here. He knows that whatever I do today has an result or a consequence tomorrow. My choices has consequences. He understands that. So he calculates by his experiences of yesterday and his hopes and dreams tomorrow, and he make a calculated decision. If this is the path I am going to take, this is where I am going to end. So he decided that what? I am going to change. I don't want to do that. I see the danger. So the simpleton, what happened? He also see the same thing. He think that tomorrow has no relation with today at all. Whatever I do today, it is only today. Tomorrow is a tomorrow. So it is not going to come at all. So that is a different thing, then I will deal with that then. So what happened? They end up in trouble. That is what happened. So this is all we do, right? So then we pray and fast and all kinds of stuff we do. You know, the old story that somebody once said, actually one guy, he came from the test and he is very anxious. He asked his grandma, "Grandma, would you please pray?" And his grandma is a prayer warrior. "Would you please pray?" And what is a prayer request? "Pray that the Everest will move to Sri Lanka." So what kind of prayer is there? "Why you have to pray?" "Because in my answer, I answered that Everest is in Sri Lanka. So mom, would you please pray that it will move there?" So that's not the very work actually. You do your job today. Not wait for the last minute. You know, 10:30 you start your homework. And 12:30 you are already tired. You don't want to do at all then. So you know that the homework is already given. It is there. So you start very early. Otherwise tomorrow you will be grumpy and grouchy and angry at your parents. What is the point of it, right? You start this early. Like thousands of other people also got the same homework. They also did it. But the wise person plan early. They know that there is a cause and effect relationship. Your choices has a consequence tomorrow. But the fool or the naive person, what he did? He think that there is nothing. Today is today. And they don't change at all. The prudent know that the habit can become their behavior. So before it happens, they change. The simple one simply don't want to act at all. What is the difference here? The prudent want to make a decision. He know that what he sow, that he will reap. What he will sow, he will reap. That's the thing. So remember that whatever you sow, that you will, this is nothing. Even the Holy Spirit will not do automatically nothing at all. You know, if you want to preach, you study the scripture. When you stand here, God will remind you. So I don't stand here and say that, "Lord, I am like a pututi, just fill me now." It won't happen at all. I have to spend time in the word and study, then only it will come. That is the same. The Holy Spirit remind us what you already know it. That is what exactly for you. That should always be there. So your direction always determines your destiny, not your intention. Your direction determines your destiny. If you want to go to Mexico, where do you go then? You always go to south. But I go to north and I'm very sincere actually. I'm going to Mexico. Where you end up? In Los Angeles. So it is your intention is not thinking. I have a very great desire to do it. No. Your destiny determined by your direction. So there we see in Proverbs chapter 27 verse 12. The principle is very simple. The prudent and the naive. The wise and the fool. The wise man think that my today is connected with my tomorrow. My choices has a consequence for tomorrow. If I don't do what I am supposed to do today, that will always affect. The people, those who, you know, only 3 or 4 people, those who were successful, those who left the college and become billionaires. And billions of other people did it. And you are not Steve Jobs, by the way. And so you have to study it today. It is very, very important. If you are the Steve Jobs, I want to be your manager also. So that's a different story. So remember this. You know, this is important, that today will affect your tomorrow. That keep in your mind. When you study, when you do your work, parents also, your choices affect your children's future also. That's an important thing. And number four, and I will finish here. Number four, very, very, very quick. And your habit will shape your life. Your habit will shape your life. In Psalms 119, verses 1 through 8, you know, you read it when you have time. Because what is a habit? Habit is a behavior that occurs automatically over and over, often unconsciously. It is a habit. It happened. Because we did this quite often. When the Duke University made a study, and they say that 40% of the actions we take every day are not the products of choices, but because of our habit. 40% of the things that we do, we don't even know. You know, sometimes I get on the car, you know, many times happened actually. My car already turned there actually to come to the church. I'm going somewhere else. So then, I know that it's not to the church today, it's not Sunday. You don't have to come here at all. But it's all in the car, you know, my pilot actually to go to the churches automatically. It is autopilot. So that's what happened. So because it is always, this was a habit, it happened. You don't even think about it. Many things that we do is a habit. But where did the habit start, by the way? The habit started, you know, it is just as a action. We keep on doing it. So the brain trained in such a way and become an autopilot. So you don't have to make anything at all. It naturally happened in such a way. But remember, the danger is that the habits not only form your schedule, the habit form your heart also. The habit, because you know, if you are conscious, many things you don't even do it. But habitually you are doing it because unconsciously you are doing it. So there is a rhythm you have to create. This is another topic we'll teach some other time, but we'll finish here. So this is what we want to do practically. Make a rhythm of life. This is a biblical principle also. There is 7 days, there is a seventh day, there is a 6 day of work, and there is a Sabbath. Right? Who started it? God did it. The Sabbath was started by God. God created day and night. Right? And we boast in ourselves actually. We think that we are night owls. I can only sleep for 4 hours and all. I did many years. Now I pay a price for that. So we will talk about the theology of body and the theology of sleeping also some other time. That's what I'm learning now. Theology of sleeping, you know. And so that's interesting stuff. Because important. God created this. God created, for 6 days he worked. The seventh day, you have a rest. God created man on the sixth day. The first day of man was what? Rest, right? God work and rest. Man rest and work. And that is what exercise. So there is a rhythm. When the people of Israel, there we see there is a seventh-day Sabbath. Then there is a monthly event. There is 3 months or so. There we come actually. There is a festivals. There are 7 festivals that we see. And that we read in Leviticus chapter 21 or so. There we see that there is a rhythm. If they are nomadic people, they are going place to place. And there is settled one place. God said there is a rhythm to reflect, to rejoice, to come together, to celebrate. There is a time. So you know, keep on working. There is a rhythm. So this is a discipline, a habit we have to create. As youngsters and parents and all of us, we need to do that. Where to say no. Learn to say no. That is the first thing to learn in life. Say no. And what are things to say no? And to say, learn to say no in certain things that is not applicable to us or useful for us. So create a rhythm of life, daily rhythm. When you get up, you start to pray and read the scripture. You start the day with the Lord in the beginning, God. Start with that. And you go and do your things needs to be done. And a daily rhythm, a weekly rhythm, a monthly rhythm. So you create, go in such a way, your habits are formed. Unknowingly, you are able to do many things. So your habit will form your life. This is important. So children, this school year, this is our prayer for you. You will be responsible. Your choices you make, you understand that not only that affect you, that affect everyone around you. It has a choice. And remember that your today is connected with the tomorrow. You cannot do anything separate from that. Many things that you want, many of the people those are sitting here because they made a choice yesterday. They decided to study. Many of their friends were watching TV and going for parties. They said, I have to stay back and study. That's where they got the degrees. the paper didn't get automatically. Because they did that, that's why they are here today. If you want that, you have to do that today. If you want that tomorrow, you want to do it today. So make that decision and your habits will form your life. That is a formatting thing. So habits are like liturgy, somebody said. It is a set of way you think and process your thing. That ending up your life. So that is an important thing. So let us pray today. There is one more thing I'll say some other time in Matthew chapter 25. God said about Jesus said about a parable about three group of people. One, a rich man gave 5 bags of gold, another 2 or minas or talents or whatever that it is, and one person won. When the master came back, the master asked this question, and the 1 bag person, what he said? He has an excuse. What was his excuse? He said the master was a rude person. I cannot say no to him. I know that he is not good. And my life is not fair. They got 5 and 2. I got only 1. In Matthew chapter 25, Jesus asked this question. But the master came and asked for an account for only thing that he has given to him. He didn't ask about why you didn't make 5. Those who have that capacity. So the 2 bag people. I think that many of us are 2 bag people. We are not as smart as many other people. But we are not as dumb as many other people either. But we have enough God has given to us. So what do you do with that? Use it wisely. Use it wisely. So this school year, so this 4 principle may guide you. We pray for that. Number 1, God created you as responsible. Responsibility is not a neutral or personal thing. Your today is affect your tomorrow. What we sow, you will reap tomorrow. And your destiny is determined by your direction, not by your intention. And the 4, your habit will form your life. Can you memorize that? 4 things. We say one more time. God created us as responsible. Children, you can say, God created us as responsible people. Responsibility is not a neutral or a personal thing. Your choices affect your people around you. Your teachers, your friends, your family. Everybody is affected by that. 3, remember that today will affect your tomorrow. Your today will affect your tomorrow. And your habit will form whatever habit you have. So make that, either not like a simpleton. You keep on doing it, thinking that you have a different result. No. You have to act. You have to change. So we pray for you. Let us close and let us pray together one more time. Father, we are grateful for this morning. Lord, these principles that you have embedded in your word, Lord, that we want to follow that. So we pray for all our children one more time, that they will be responsible for that and they will make use of it, O God. Lord, we remind ourselves every day when they make a choice that not only affect me, that affect my parents, my siblings, my relatives, Lord, my community, my church. Lord, above and beyond all those things that affect your reputation, O God. As your children, Lord, we want to represent you. When we don't do that, O Lord, that is a bad thing for your name, O God. So remind us always in our schools, in our campuses, in our associations, Lord, in our friendship. Lord, help us, O Lord, we pray. Lord, again I pray, Lord, every child that we have, Lord, they will have godly friends, O Lord. Lord, they will not be influenced by any of these things. They will be guarded by your word. Lord, they will be conformed to your will in their lives. Lord, I pray that enable us to make the decisions always in mind that my choices will affect my tomorrow. So we pray again for our children, our teachers, our parents. Lord, as parents, we are helpless. We don't know sometimes what to do or how to do. We cannot change any heart, O God. But you can. You are able to do it, O God. So we commit ourselves into your hands also. We surrender our life to you. We pray again for our children. This school year will be greatest in all aspects, O Father. Lord, as we come back in summer, next summer again, we can look back and say, yes, the Lord was with me. The Lord was with every family, O God. And we pray through His children. Lord, I pray that they will be able to bring others to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. They will be missionaries in the respective place, O God. We love you. We thank you. We praise you. In your precious name we pray. May the never failing, everlasting, unconditional, eternal love of our Father, sustaining, strengthening grace of our Lord Jesus, the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit that guides us in all the truth, be with all of us now and forevermore. Amen.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart. I